Thank you. The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 11199 in the name of Brian Whittle on recognising the success of HMP Kilmarnock. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate, please press the request to speak button, and I call on Brian Whittle to open the debate. Mr Whittle.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I am delighted to rise to celebrate the great work the HMP Kilmarnock do and have been doing to support the rehabilitation of offenders and the work with the third sector organisations in supporting families of prisoners as well as helping the transition of prisoners back into their communities. And I would commend the work of third sector organisations like the Foundation Hub, who have a facility just outside the prison, and to Centre Stage for the work they do. And it's really important work, the way in which 6 to 8 weeks before a prisoner's release, they start to work with them to help them that transition back into the community. After all, many of those who are incarcerated at His Majesty's pleasure are not bad people. They're people who have made bad choices. HMP Kilmarnock, when we visited them several times, I'm always impressed by the new skills that they offer to the prisoners and to the education. And the first time I was in Kilmarnock Prison, being shown round, I was taken into the art class there, and there was a gentleman there painting, which was quite a magnificent painting. And talking to him, he said he'd only taken up art when he was incarcerated. And I asked him why it took him, to go to prison to take up art, and his answer was, "I never got the opportunity before." And I think in there lies a significant message. Now, the Parliament has really good links with HMSP Kilmarnock, and I think it's quite important that we do that, because for me it was about making sure that, yes, they have a debt to pay to society, but we have to always remind them that they are not forgotten. And to that end, Presiding Officer, I remember offering a football match between the parliamentary football team and the prisoners, and which I remember asking the parliamentary football team if we'd take part, as they all dive for cover. But we did. We took part. It was a tri-team tournament, and the prison guards also took part. So, although I've got to say that the prison guards weren't all that au fait with us standing at the side watching the prisoners versus the prison guards shouting "Mean Machine" at that point. Now, I'm looking around the chamber here to see those who recognise that that reference. And then we then decided to take the parliamentary rugby team down and play a tournament of sevens, which was again a great occasion. I have to say, I did get sent off to the sin bin. I know you'll not believe that, Presiding Officer. Apparently, I was a bit mouthy. And I got sent to the sin bin in that particular one. And I've also been in to Kilmarnock Prison and taken circuit classes with the prisoners. So I think the way in which we've engaged with Kilmarnock Prison has been really exemplary. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, given the successes of Kilmarnock Prison in their care and rehabilitation of prisoners, one has to ask why in 2019 the then Justice Secretary Humza Yousaf gave the throwaway comment during a presentation to the Scottish Prison Service Conference that he was going to take Kilmarnock Prison back into public ownership. No reasoning or forethought as to why he decided this course of action, and Deputy Presiding Officer, to this day, despite repeatedly being asked to question, the Scottish Government have yet to deliver any kind of coherent response. And it smacks really of a headline grabbing decision rather than a well thought out and reasoned one. So, Presiding Officer, we have a prison successfully rehabilitating prisoners through their education and skills training, with third sector integration supporting prisoners' families, supporting prisoners as they approach release, with all they will need to reintegrate into society. We have an operator who are willing to build a new 240-bed wing at no cost to the taxpayer, with an additional 100 jobs being created at a time when the prison population is causing an increasing pressure on the Scottish prison estate. And we all have a Scottish Government who have made the decision, for what can only be deduced as ideologically driven reasons, to bring the prison into public ownership, because, of course, they know better. My colleagues, Russell Finlay, Sharon Dowie and I, visited the prison recently to meet with the Governor and representatives of the prison officers so they could raise their serious concerns, including the fact that, despite with only 9 weeks to go, the process of how harmonisation will occur at all levels still remains unclear. Yet they were advised 2 years ago that this was happening. Now, the letter that showed us from the SPS now suggests that TOOP will take about 12 months. And they have to ask the question, why? And they said that the prison staff will all be SPS public servants from the 17th of March 2024, operating and managing a public service prison. And while I accept that TOOP may take 4 months or less, with staff receiving respective T's and C's in line with the public sector, equivalent backdated to the 17th of March, the measures that the letter does not state indications are the harmonisation took that the public sector pay rates will kick in from the date of up to 12 months after the transition and might not be backdated. Now, this is morally wrong. Separately, the current SPS pay negotiations are now into 2024, and I know there is an attempt at a two-year pay deal. HMP Kilmarnock agreed their 2023 pay deal last year with the Serco. And this has been brought forward to allow Kilmarnock to coincide with the SPS pay review for 2024. Staff are entitled to a pay review. If a two-year pay deal is finally accepted with SPS versus TUS, how will the 2024 pay review balance for HMSP Kilmarnock staff who will be public servants, or is the suggestion that staff will fall further behind their public sector counterparts during 2024 and a greater injustice, potentially? So given the state of the public finances, which are well documented, taking away the ideology of nationalism and considering the current condition of public prisons in Scotland with increased overcrowding and dilapidation, is it too late to re-engage with the existing provider to reopen the offer of a building of a third house block, further enhancing the existing prison where the existing operator has experience and history of quick builds and continuing to operate at significantly reduced cost versus public sector operations, and providing that much-needed new prison space? This is a political decision, and I do get that. However, is it the correct decision for the Scottish taxpayer? The union community representing the prison officers' position fully expect their members to revert to SPS terms and conditions immediately following the transfer on 17th of March. This is an exclusive of all pay rates and bandings, and therefore within the first month salary deposited by SPS to all HMP Kilmarnock staff, then their members will reasonably expect the salary and individual banding to reflect that of all colleagues across the Scottish Prison Service. It is the community's opinion that the SPS are withholding the imposition of full harmonisation due to public cost implications, both for industrial and political reasons. So in summary, if community members in HMP Kilmarnock are not reverted to complete parity with all SPS colleagues as of March 17, 2024, then they have already given notice to the SPS that they will raise the appropriate claims on behalf of all their affected members immediately, and further, any failure to treat the members with complete parity is likely to cause industrial unrest. So this is where we are, Presiding Officer. A puzzling decision made on the hoof by Humza Yousaf that will cost the public purse more, will not see the building of 240 more places by a successful operation who have delivered a service that supports prisoners and their families, that works with the third sector to ensure successful integration into society and reduce reoffending. So I once again have to ask, HMP Kilmarnock for all the successes, and in doing so, ask the Scottish Government to explain their decision to bring it into public ownership. Surely it's not too late to ensure that the debt the best service is maintained and that staff are not disadvantaged when this takeover happens in just 9 weeks. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Russell Finlay. Mr Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer, and thanks of course to Brian Whittle for bringing his motion to the Chamber, which was happy to support earlier today, on the achievements of HMP Kilmarnock in my constituency, or Bowhouse, as we affectionately call it down there. I certainly recognise and applaud the tremendous work done under the guidance of the redoubtable Craig Thompson, the director, over several years there. It always was and still is a pleasure to visit and hear firsthand what the latest developments are. I say hear because if you know Craig, you have to be ready to listen a lot, and it's always a pleasure to be in his company. When you get the chance, as we do, Presiding Officer, to visit a prison or any other facility serving the public, you quickly gain an impression of the leadership. And I can say that from the minute I met Craig and his team, I got the clear impression that the prison and the management approach at Bow House was in very safe hands. And I will be absolutely delighted if Craig chooses to continue in post during and hopefully long after to help guide us through the transition into the SPS. Presiding Officer, COVID was a huge challenge to us all, and particularly in our prisons, where we had a clear duty to keep staff and prisoners safe. The way the prison dealt with difficult circumstances during that time was a testament to the commitment of the entire Serco team, and they're to be commended for this in particular. Brian Whittle mentioned a few of the local organisations who have close links with the prison, Centre Stage and Recovery Enterprises, or just two. Their support and link work has been nothing short of amazing. And while some of the formal local authority support arrangements stopped during COVID, our colleagues at Recovery Enterprises kept going, providing essential support for prisoners on their release from prison. So a huge thank you to them too. I think it's fair to say, of course, that the 25-year contract has had its ups and downs over the years. And I recall shortly after my first election win in 2007 that the union reps came to see me to complain about the contract conditions imposed in the prison by the then Labour executive who set up the initial arrangements for the prison. One of those standout conditions in the contract was that Serco were fined every time a mobile phone was discovered within the prison. A curious rule that meant good policing and security within the prison led to a punishing fine. Despite many attempts by me and others to review and modernise some of those conditions, they basically remained in place. However, looking forward, the transition arrangements are well underway, and as I understand it, the Serco team will transfer under their current terms and conditions and can look forward to some improvements in those as they progress. Overall, we're hoping to see more posts in the prison in the coming weeks and months too. My plea to the Cabinet Secretary, Presiding Officer, and to the SPS going forward is to build on the strengths and achievements that the Serco team have delivered for us in Kilmarnock, to continue to work closely with our local organisations, to further that close working relationship, and to engage with the local businesses who support the prison and who benefit from the support the prison gives them too. Presiding Officer, as the contract comes to an end in March, and while it might be the end of an old saying for Serco and Kilmarnock, I want to put on record my thanks to the entire Serco team, led by Craig Thompson, for the magnificent work done for us over the past 25 years, and their representatives too, has to be said. It has been a pleasure to work with you all. And so I look forward, Presiding Officer, to the beginning of a new chapter for the future of the prison in Kilmarnock. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Coffey. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Carol Mockin. Mr Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was going to write a speech, but then I found this memo, which I wrote following a visit to Kilmarnock last October, along with my colleagues Brian Whittle and Sharon Dowie. And let me just read an abridged version of the memo. It begins, memo SNP transfer of HMP Kilmarnock from private to public ownership. Today we visited Serco-owned and operated HMP Kilmarnock, which will transfer into public ownership at midnight on Saturday, March 16, 2024. Prison Director Craig Thompson and his senior colleagues were critical of the SNP's decision to transfer, the lack of explanation for doing so, and a worrying lack of communication about how it will happen. Mr Thompson says it will be more costly to taxpayers while delivering worse outcomes in relation to reoffending to the detriment of everyone. He said the first anyone knew of it was in 2019 when then Justice Secretary Humza Yousaf appeared on the evening news to say that it was happening. The SNP's sole motivation appears to be ideological. Private is bad, public is good. And then I list various bullet points. Serco offered to build a new block at no extra cost to taxpayers and which would now probably be open. But this was rejected by Scottish Government after, and I quote, 15 minutes. The annual cost to Scottish Government of Kilmarnock is £16 million, but a report found that it's the least expensive prison in the UK and that the annual cost will rise by up to £5 million, and no one appears to know the transfer cost. Mr Thompson estimates that due to the differences between contracts, Kilmarnock may need to hire up to 100 more officers. The SPS will not retain the in-house psychology team, education staff or housekeepers who are in payroll. They will instead be subcontracted. The same applies to Kilmarnock's 4 drug detection dogs, which have stopped £1 million plus worth of drugs from getting inside. There are 84 body-worn cameras across all 17 Scottish prisons. 56 of these are in Kilmarnock. But the SPS say they don't want them. So Serco plans to send these to one of their English prisons. Kilmarnock installed in-cell telephones many years ago. This meant they did not need to emulate Hamza Yusuf's disastrous and costly prisoner mobile phone scheme. As a condition of contract, 10% of Kilmarnock's revenue is spent in the local community. This will end. A Serco senior executive flew from Australia to attend a meeting with the Scottish Government. Mr Thompson understands that the then SNP Justice Secretary did not attend. Kilmarnock staff use an app for rotas, holidays, etc. However, this will revert to paper and pencil under the SNP. The SPS may not recognise Community Trade Union, which represents Kilmarnock staff. The union believes this could result in an impasse between staff and the SPS. Anna Sarwar is a member of this union. I wonder what he's saying about it. Presiding Officer, that brings me to the end of my memo, the end of my speech, and frankly, the end of my tether. The SNP's treatment of HMP Kilmarnock is a metaphor for the ideological incompetence of this sorry excuse for a government. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Finlay. I now call Cara Mochan to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Brian Whittle for bringing this debate to the Chamber as members' business. Now, I always seek to offer recognition to workers and staff, and so I join Brian and others in doing so. We know that the Justice Service is under enormous pressure with increasing numbers of prisoners within the estate, many prisons across Scotland, many prisons in Scotland in quite a poor state, and much of our prison estate extremely old. So it is nice today to be able to look at important examples of good practice which may be helping prisoners and their wider families. I really want to pay tribute to prison officers and staff within the prison service. It is a profession which is often overlooked. They have a complex job role and their pay does not reflect this. Yet we see them across the prison estate working with others to secure a positive future for the prisoners that they support. Now, during my research for this debate, I found a comment from Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, I think her name is, the Inspector of Prisons for Scotland, and she said, if we bring people into prison and do nothing with them, we will release them back into society angrier than they were when they came in. This is not appropriate. As a person in the community, I would like to think that the prison service is working with those people to reduce the risks when they leave. This statement was made during a budget scrutiny meeting, but the statement did stand out to me as someone who's not an expert in this area. And I think that adding to this, we know that many in our prison population are there due to very complex social issues, which has been mentioned by other speakers, and perhaps they may be reoffending or at risk of reoffending because, on the whole, we do not support them in the way that we should. There is strong evidence that prison used as a vehicle to care, support and rehabilitate helps to return individuals into the community with a purpose for their future, which is obviously helpful for them and their families and communities. In doing a little bit of research, I saw a pathway which talked about 7 ways of helping prisoners not to reoffend, to help them with accommodation, to help them with attitudes, thinking and behaviour, to help them with relationships with their children and their families, to deal with things that are important issues in society currently, drugs and alcohol being one. Brian mentioned about art and education and training and employment, to look at finance, benefits and debt that may be there and help them with that as they transition back into the community and, very importantly, their health. Apologies. And I think in my reading of the good work ongoing at Kilmarnock, the organisations that have been mentioned in the motion and the staff seek to cover all of these areas. The reality overall is that although we do have progressive policy within Scotland, we do tend to have a punitive culture, and to some degree we've always done that, I think sometimes can come across. And there is a cultural reluctance sometimes to change, and we can always be guilty, all of us can be guilty of that, and when we're changing such large organisations that can be difficult. The Prison and Justice Service have been firefighting for some time. I think even government recognises this. There is a backlog in the courts and there has been overcrowding, never mind the pandemic. So I think I don't have much time. I want to just mention the organisations and the collaborative rehabilitative approach that has gone on at HMP Kilmarnock. And I think we would all wish to support this as we go on. The visitor centre, the fact that they liaise and work with local groups to make sure when prisoners are returning, they can have that opportunity to make it work. So like Brian and others, I hope that this approach not only continues in the years ahead at Kilmarnock, but that it can be seen as a way ahead that we can replicate more widely across the prison estate. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I call Sharon Dowie. Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank my colleague Brian Whittle for bringing this debate to the Chamber. HMP Kilmarnock is a success story. It's a well-run operation, it supports local jobs, it delivers good value for money for taxpayers. In those respects, it is something of a rarity in Scotland. In the SNP era, it's rare to see high performance and costs that don't spiral out of control. It seems the sensible decision would be to have continued this successful HMP Kilmarnock contract. The smart move would be to model our other prisons on HMP Kilmarnock. But instead, SNP ministers have chosen to end this success story. They have chosen, for purely ideological reasons, to nationalise HMP Kilmarnock. It is an extraordinary and short-sighted and baffling move. It's a damaging decision that will cost taxpayers money, hinder efforts to rehab prisoners, and leave staff in a worse spot. They could have let the prison continue running well, as it has been in recent years. Instead, as my colleague Brian Whittle outlined earlier, SNP ministers have created all kinds of problems for themselves by not learning from this success story. Firstly, they have put at risk many effective things that the prison does. HMP Kilmarnock has many bespoke systems and programmes which may not continue, including a digital management tool to book medical appointments and family contact visits. And last year, it introduced a Veterans in Custody Breakfast Club, a very worthwhile and commendable programme. I hope it continues after nationalisation, but that remains to be seen. Secondly, from speaking with the current director of HMP Kilmarnock, it's clear that staffing is going to be problematic for the nationalised prison. The many experienced staff doing a great job at the moment will need to change the way they work. Staff contracts will be radically different. A lot of new recruitment will be necessary in light of this change. Recruitment may become even more challenging if current staff leave because of worsening working conditions. As my colleague Russell Finlay said, when they nationalise HMP Kilmarnock, the SNP will take body-worn cameras away from prison officers. They may be sent south to English prisons, and that makes no sense whatsoever. It was a positive that HMP Kilmarnock provided those devices to officers, and that should continue. That is an example of cost-cutting from the SNP, but, unbelievably, it looks like nationalising HMP Kilmarnock will be far more expensive than the current contract under which HMP Kilmarnock provides great value for taxpayers. But perhaps even more shocking, we don't yet know how much more nationalisation will cost than the current approach. No estimates are available. That work should really have been done before any plans to end this contract were announced. At the Scottish Parliament Justice Committee in November, I asked the Scottish Prison Service if a full assessment of budgetary requirements had been completed. Just a few months before the date of nationalisation, it still hadn't been. It's unclear if it's completed now. Value for money doesn't appear to have been a consideration in this decision. There appears to have been no studies done on how much more it will cost taxpayers. According to some estimates, nationalisation may cost £3 to £5 million more. That is several million pounds that could have been spent on schools, hospitals or other essential public services. But, Presiding Officer, it seems the SNP were never interested in the positives of HMP Kilmarnock. They were not interested that it is good value for money and run effectively. They were not interested in saving money so it could be spent on schools and hospitals. For purely ideological reasons, SNP ministers will end the success story of HMP Kilmarnock and Scottish taxpayers will suffer as a result. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. And I now call on Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking Brian Whittle for securing this debate this evening. This is a very timely debate, and I, for one, certainly appreciate the very fulsome account that Mr Whittle and others have gave to the excellent work that goes on within the walls in HMP Kilmarnock. I'm perhaps less impressed with his endeavours in football and rugby, but in a more serious point, it is imperative that, as members of this Parliament, that we do engage with the prison service and the individual establishments that are within our regions and constituencies. It is often the case that work within our prisons can be hidden, and we need to recognise that what happens in prisons matters. It is not the end of the line, because most people will be serving a determinate sentence and will return to our communities. So I'm really pleased that Carol Mauchin, Willie Coffey and also Mr Whittle have acknowledged the importance of prisons as rehabilitative institutions, and that they have a role to play in improving community safety and changing lives. I had the pleasure last year of visiting HMP Kilmarnock last August, and I think just walking around the prison and spending time with the director, Craig Thompson, who is clearly a very experienced governor, and the opportunity to speak to staff and prisoners, I felt I got a really good sense of the significant efforts, skill and enthusiasm that staff at that establishment bring. Now, I'll just touch on the issue of private prisons. And can I start by saying I certainly will give an account of the government's position in and around this matter. But can I also point to the fact that I have a private prison in my own constituency. It's run by a different provider. Now, I and this government have always had fundamental objections to private prisons, but nonetheless, I, for one, have never sought to kick that prison, or indeed the people who work within it, just because of its mode of ownership. And it is also the case that even although we have two private prisons in Scotland, that when things are, as Willie Coffey says, a bit rocky or have their ups and downs, because the SPS have responsibilities for the contract, it is also beholden on them to step in or lean in to any institution in Scotland when there are issues. And when I visited Kilmarnock, I was very pleased to hear about the positive impact of the sustained early engagement of the Scottish Prison Service and CERCLE with staff in preparation for the transition of HMP Kilmarnock to public ownership in March. And as it has been noted, this is a significant transition and it is the first transfer to public ownership of a privately operated prison in Scotland. And as members may be aware or recall, that decision was taken in 2021. It is no secret that this government, since its formation in 2007, that our position has always been that prisons, like other significant public services, should be managed in the public sector. And at a really fundamental core level, that is because public safety and not private profit is paramount. And the decision around these contracts were, of course, legacy arrangements from previous administrations. And I'm happy to take
Russell Pinnock.
Thank you. It's just on that specific point. In response to a written question, the Cabinet Secretary told me that the decision to transfer was made in 2021. However, Hamza Yousaf made the announcement in 2019. Was that a sham announcement?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, listen, Presiding Officer, we're trying to have a really serious debate here about the quality of care and the quality of supervision that goes on in HMP Kilmarnock. And I'll get on to it in a moment, talking about the successes of the organisation that has to be maintained when it takes that significant step of coming back into public ownership. The reality is, with a 25-year contract that was going to come to an end, there was only two choices. You either re-tender the contract or you bring it back into public ownership. And for the reasons that I've outlined, this government took the decision to bring the prison into public ownership. Now, I do, Presiding Officer, in the time that I have left, want to talk about the successes of HMP Kilmarnock, because it's not just me that has noticed the professionalism and care of the staff at HMP Kilmarnock. Independent prison monitors note in their annual report the extremely positive experiences of visiting the prison. They note a well-run prison that feels safe and orderly, with excellent provision of purposeful activity on a daily basis. And that is something to be proud of course.
Brian Whistle.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Does she not recognise she's actually giving us the narrative of why it should remain as it is because of the huge success that it is? I understand that there is this idea around a service like that shouldn't be in a private ownership, but surely it's about outcomes. Surely must be. It's been run very, very well. Why would you change that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Because, as I've already said, Presiding Officer, the contract was coming to an end, so you either re-tender for the contract or you bring the establishment into public ownership. I've outlined the reasons why this government believes public ownership of prisons is preferable. But what I am acknowledging is that independent inspections and experts have acknowledged that HMP Kilmarnock is on a par with other SPS establishments. And it is important, Presiding Officer, in the very brief time that I have left, that we do, like others, acknowledge some of the successes of HMP Kilmarnock. And I was particularly interested, and Sharon Dowie mentioned it, that they introduced a monthly Veterans in Custody Breakfast Club, and something that I had an interest when I was first a member of this Parliament many years ago, because of my prison background, I was very interested in the prevalence of veterans within our justice system. And it's great to see this initiative take place. HMP Kilmarnock also have a very strong community partnerships and excellent intelligence relationships, and they work very closely with the local police. And as Brian Whittle, Willie Coffey and Carol Mockin have also paid tribute to the organisation Recovery Enterprise Scotland, who I am very familiar with, particularly in my previous role as Minister for Drugs Policy, and that they have taken on the delivery of the Prison Visitor Centre at HMP Kilmarnock. And that, of course, is supported by Scottish Government funding. And the Foundation's Hub Visitor Centre is supportive. It's an inclusive environment for people. no thank you for people in custody and their families. Presiding officer, can I just end before you start chastising me for overrunning my time? I just want to put on record my thanks to HMP Kilmarnock and to take this opportunity to thank all the current and previous staff and management at HMP Kilmarnock for their important services to the justice system in Scotland. HMP Kilmarnock has been well managed and forward-thinking prison in Scotland for 25 years. And I can assure this chamber that the Scottish Prison Service will harness and build on that success after transition. And to end on the point that Willie Coffey has made, it is important to build on its strengths and achievements and support the prison in this new chapter.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.